We now have our very own director of culture, Miss Luce Hodge-Smith, talking for us. Miss Luce Hodge-Smith is the director of the culture in the Department of Culture, a role she has held since January of 2007. Mrs. Hodge-Smith was previously the education officer for culture in the former Department of Education and Culture, as well as a member of the team at the BVI Tourist Board. Ms. Hodge-Smith holds a BS degree in business administration from the College of St. Elizabeth, New Jersey, USA, and an MBA from Wright State University, Ohio, USA. As Director of Culture, she is responsible for overseeing the daily operations of the department, advising the Permanent Secretary on cultural matters, preparing budget estimates and annual reports, planning and implementing activities to promote and preserve the cultural heritage of the British Virgin Islands, among other functions and duties. Mrs. Hodge-Smith has been an active participant in UNESCO's World Heritage activities and has advocated for the BVI's continuous efforts to one day gain the prestigious status on being listed on the World Heritage List. In December of 2015, Mrs. Hodge-Smith was nominated and selected by her museum colleagues throughout the region as Vice President of the Museums Association of the Caribbean. Ladies and gentlemen, Luce Hodge-Smith.
Good morning, everyone. Today, my presentation is entitled Safeguarding the British Virgin Islands Historical Sites, a Perspective from the Department of Culture. Ms. Dr. Kent has asked us really to give an overview of what the department has been doing over the years as it pertains to the preservation of our historical sites. And he had also asked us to give a brief about the works of the Museums Association of the Caribbean. So my presentation today basically is a brief introduction about the department itself, some of the efforts of the department, for example, the Virgin Islands Historics Register, the Virgin Islands Museums Council, our works with UNESCO over the years, our assistance with various archaeological digs here in the territory, St. Philip's Church, International Museum Day 2016, and we'll wrap up with the Museums of the Association of the Caribbean and our perspective on the way forward. Just a brief, the Department of Culture was established in 2006. As mentioned earlier in my introduction, we previously was part of the portfolio of the Department of Education and Culture. We have established a cultural policy which guides and mandates the operations and the activities of the department, which was established in 2013. We do have some limitations as we are a department mostly of administrative staff. We don't necessarily have the required technical staff in order for us to truly make an impact. But with the limited resources and limitations that we have, we are able still to make an impact on the efforts in preserving the historical sites and on other cultural matters. And hence our efforts in collaborating with a number of related agencies. Now, the first thing I want to talk about in terms of our efforts, and this isn't necessarily a direct initiative by the Department of Culture, but it is where an initiative that the department, well, prior to the department being established, because this was done, works on the Historic Register started way back in 2005. And as the education officer responsible for culture, I served on the committee that was working on establishing a Historic Register of the Virgin Islands. Now, the Historic Register of the Virgin Islands, basically, it's a part of the Town Planning Act, where it forms part of the Act. There's a section that deals with this establishing of this historic register. Hence the work that was done from 2005 to about 2009, where the officer, Ms. Allison Hill, had done extensive work on on establishing this historic register. Unfortunately, the work had ceased when she left the department. Work that has been done was a list of historical sites, a list of historical sites on Main Street, the establishment of Main Street. I think Dr. Smith mentioned about the historical significance of the sites on Main Street. There was a paper done about establishing Main Street as a historic district. So works have been done on that. There has been a lot of cabinet papers moving forward with the establishment of this historic register. As I mentioned before, it's really the mandate of the Town and Country Planning Department through its Planning Act that this historic register falls. And I think the rationale for having this historic register listed under the Planning Act is because persons would submit their proposals or the development plans to Planning Department, Town and Country Planning Department, for permissions to build and do whatever development on their property. And if by chance there's a historic site or historic, there's historical significance on that particular property, then the register would deal with this historic site on the private property, as also mentioned before by a previous speaker, that one of the issues that we have with the historical sites is that they are basically on private property. So the establishment of this site was to control the developments around these properties, and the Town and Country Planning having the first being the first point of contact when you want to develop your property. And if there is an interest in this particular site when it comes to historical sites, then the Town and Country Planning would have the authority not to approve the site or the development, or to give you stipulations as to what you can do with this your plans. But unfortunately, the historic register was not finalized. And although extensive work had been done on it, and just to say that those are the previous efforts, the current efforts now are to revive the efforts to finalize the historic register, where all the sites will be listed on this historic register, and they will be controlled in a sense in terms of the development, as Dr. Smith Angel mentioned earlier, the fact that him and Dr. Kent went to our site, and a couple of weeks after, a road was in the middle of it. So the historic register, it will be used, the rationale is to help to safeguard some of our remaining historical sites. And we have an agreement, it's verbal, but we will have something official with the Town and Country Planning Department, and they have kind of verbally agreed with us that they will allow us to continue the works of establishing the historic register. So it's not reinventing the wheel, but picking up from where it was left off in terms of getting this historic register in existence. And I mentioned too, the Education and Information Management Committee under the Department of Disaster Management, the historic register forms part of their mandate of that committee to ensure that this historic register becomes a reality. And I am a member of that committee, and that is my responsibility to ensure that this historic register is in place. So that's our first effort. And then we will be establishing our Virgin Islands Museum Council. As we know, museums play very intricate roles in not just establishing museums, managing the museums, changing the art, the displays, and welcoming the visitors, and having tours, and etc. But within its boundaries and without its boundaries, museums play a very intricate role in the preservation of historical sites. The artifacts that are discovered and taken from the archaeological digs or the sites are reposited into the museums for display and for educational purposes, to educate the local populace and the visitors about these historical sites and these artifacts. So we will be forming a museum council of the Virgin Islands, and the rationale for that is to bring all the museums together, form a network of museums within the Virgin Islands, so that everyone will share in their issues and concerns. It will promote the promotion and the education of the museums and the displays and what is listed in all the museums. We have quite a bit of museums here in the Virgin Islands, and there's the Old Government House Museum, the Virgin Islands Folk Museum, the Maritime Museum that's here at the college. And then there is the 1780 Sugar Works Museum, Lower Estate Sugar Works Museum. And all these, and then there's the establishment soon to come of the Old Prison Museum. And then there are plans to establish museums on, and then there's the Faulkner House Museum in Anigada. And there are plans to establish other museums throughout the territory. So the idea is to bring all these museums together, form one council, promotion, educational, etc. And the terms of reference of this council, of course, would be, as I mentioned, some of those things. But informing or establishing Friends of the Museums, where we'll get volunteers to work in these museums in off hours, particularly with the tourists that are coming off the cruise ships, that they are sometimes walking the streets on a Sunday when the cruise ship is in and the museums are closed. So we will establish volunteers that will be willing to work in the museums on those hours. We are hoping to launch this this council during our celebrations of International Museum Day. So hopefully we will get this established. The other, again, based on our plans for International Museum Day, as I mentioned before, museums play an intricate role, and one of the other activities that we are involved in is the observation of International Museum Day. And ironically, International Museum Day, the theme for International Museum this year is museums and cultural landscapes. And here we are talking about cultural landscapes, cultural historical landscapes. So it's basically the protecting and enhancing of these landscapes, the focus of the theme this year. And we do have some, the theme in a sense makes museums responsible for their landscapes. They're asked to contribute. Sometimes museum curators are asked to contribute knowledge, expertise, and take an active role in the management and upkeep of these cultural and historical landscapes. So it's great that we are having the observation of International Museum Day this year, and under the theme, Museums and Cultural Landscapes. So the date is actually May 18th, and throughout the world, museums throughout the world will be observing this day. They will have a week of activities, a day of activities, or simply observing in many shapes and forms of the observation of International Museum Day. As I've mentioned before, we're planning to launch the VI Museum Council. We're planning to produce a brochure on some of our historic sites. I know there's quite a bit of information on the historical sites, but we are planning to do something as well in terms of promoting and advocating for the preservation of our historical sites based on the theme this year. We're planning to clean up the surroundings of a particular museum. I won't say which one it is right now because we haven't sent the official correspondence to the management of that particular museum, but it's supposed to be a territory-wide project where we'll invite the public to come out and help us to tidy up the surroundings of this particular museum. And by that way, we will get the public involved, and hopefully we'll continuously get the public's involvement in safeguarding our heritage. The other area that we are very much involved in, and this is going to be a lengthy one, is UNESCO. As most persons are aware, UNESCO is very, very involved in the preservation of heritage throughout the world. And UNESCO's World Heritage Convention of 1972 This was ratified by the United Kingdom, and the Virgin Islands being a territory of the United Kingdom, automatically this convention applies to the Virgin Islands as well. We have gained quite a lot from the UNESCO's efforts in helping to assist the Caribbean region in protecting and preserving its historical sites. But the UNESCO's World Heritage Convention, I should say, deals basically with placing historical sites on the World Heritage List. And there's a long, tedious process, but we have seen sites within the region, the Caribbean region, being placed on the historic World Heritage List. Most recently, the Jamaica was able to get its site on the World Heritage List. I forgot the name at the moment. And after years of working on it, I think also Barbados recently had its city in Barbados, Bridgetown. I can't remember the capital of it, but it's also a historic town in Barbados, was placed on the World Heritage List. And there are other sites in the region. And the works that we have been doing is the World Heritage Convention basically deals with cultural and historical sites. We have collaborated in the past with the National Parks Trust, where one of the officers from the National Parks Trust and myself traveled to various meetings and workshops organized by UNESCO for the training of our efforts in one day possibly being listed on the World Heritage List. And the person from the National Parks Trust, they represented, of course, the natural heritage, and myself, the cultural heritage. So there's been quite a bit of work. We have gained so much. Just to give you an idea, there is the 2014 to 2019 Caribbean Action Plan for World Heritage. And as a participant of these activities, we are encouraged within the region to follow this action plan and to do as much as we possibly can to follow it and to implement and carry out as much of the plan as we possibly can. The action plan consists of a specific agenda that will serve mainly to promote sub-regional cooperation, to reinforce synergies, to mobilize resources, and to strengthen coordination of Caribbean World Heritage Communities' efforts. Its sustainability depends on effective identification of resources to secure financing, and this action plan has been designed to respond to specific contexts of the Caribbean and the needs identified by state parties. So that's in a nutshell what this action plan is about. And just to give you an idea of the context of the Caribbean sub-regional context, all countries in the sub-region have ratified the World Heritage Convention. And just to list the countries, we have Antigua and Barbuda, Bahamas, Barbados, Belize, Cuba, Dominica, Grenada, Guyana, Haiti, Jamaica, Dominican Republic, St. Kitts and Nevis, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, St. Lucia, Suriname, and Trinidad and Tobago. And to which, as I mentioned before, because we are a territory of the United Kingdom, they ratified the convention, so we are automatically a part of this. The Caribbean has 21 sites inscribed in the World Heritage List, 15 cultural sites, and 6 natural sites recognized for their outstanding universal value. Now, the efforts of the Virgin Islands, or the BVI, has been quite long and quite extensive. In attending the workshops, we've always faced a challenge as to who we should contact, who is our direct contact to the UK, because we would attend these meetings and they would say, well, you're welcome to be here, the information is beneficial, but you can't go any further without your direct contact to the UK because you're under the United Kingdom. So we had done the work. One of the things that you have to do is you have to list your tentative list. You have to prepare a tentative list. The tentative list is based in potential historical sites that you would like to see or work on towards being listed, hopefully one day, on the World Heritage List. And we have faced the challenge because we couldn't find our source in the United Kingdom. Fortunately for me, while I was on secondment at the London office, I was able to find the department that was responsible for us when it comes to dealings with UNESCO. This was the Department of Culture, Sports, and Media. I had a meeting with the director, and I hit the spot. So he indicated to us that the Virgin Islands, or the BVI, did have some sites on the tentative list. But unfortunately, at that time, he couldn't tell me what the sites were. I know in the past, there's been quite a bit of work before my time. I've heard of the baths being listed on the, being for consideration. I've heard of the Kingstown Church, the St. Philip's Church. I've heard of the copper mine ruins. I've heard of the Anegada Reef being a natural site. And I think there was one more. I think there was another one at the Belmont Estate. Those were sites that were considered for the British Virgin Islands to put forward on our tentative list. So unfortunately, at that meeting, the time of the meeting, he couldn't tell me what the sites were that were listed through the UK. But I was told that the BVI did have some sites on the tentative list. Since then, I've been in contact with the office, and the thing about it is, being under the UK, we can't send our information directly to UNESCO. We have to send it through the UK. So in preparation for a meeting in 2014, I contacted the office again, and they informed me that we had just missed the opportunity to be placed on the tentative list, and we have to wait 10 years. It's a long, tedious process. So we are waiting, and we have to send our potential sites for consideration on the World Heritage List through the UK. The UK will then agree or not agree. And if they do agree, then they will send forward the list to the UNESCO. So, but we're not giving up because, like I say, there's been work before my time. And the fortunate thing about UNESCO is if you don't, by chance, make it on the World Heritage List, the information is still relevant. It's still an opportunity to use the information from UNESCO to help us to safeguard and protect our historical sites. So with the World Heritage Operational Guidelines, there are those four things that I pulled out. In nominating our historical sites or even selecting a site for consideration on World Heritage List, we have to look at the site and its authenticity. We have to prove authenticity. We have to prove the integrity of the site, the universal value of the site. There are other opportunities. If you can't present an individual site in the Virgin Islands, there are opportunities of transboundary nominations where we can join with other countries within the region and have a transboundary nomination. So there, those are those opportunities as well. I know for sure there are some countries that are in the region that are currently working on a transboundary nomination. It includes St. Lucia, Grenada, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and St. Martin. And it might include another country. And they are working on their coastal forts as a transboundary nomination. And I've considered, because we have some coastal forts, if we can join in that effort as well for consideration as being a transboundary nomination. So I mentioned the UK ties. One of the good things about UNESCO is they're always fascinated and very cooperative and very generous with the training of individuals in these particular areas. So UNESCO has for the World Heritage, they have a Caribbean capacity building program. And there are five, and it's for World Heritage. And there are five modules. And the Tailoring or Cultural Heritage Management Program for the Caribbean. I'll just give you a brief about it. The Caribbean Capacity Building Program, CCBP, is a long-term training program focusing on cultural and natural heritage management, aiming to create a Caribbean network of heritage experts. What is the CCBP for? It's to strengthen the capacities of Caribbean institutions in the field of immovable cultural heritage conservation and management, to disseminate and implement the core principles of World Heritage Convention and best practices of heritage restoration, conservation, and management, to offer an academic and technical network where the dynamics between conservation management, and development are analyzed and viable solutions for specific projects and case studies are proposed. So these five modules, the first one deals with the application of the World Heritage Convention. The second one deals with tourism management in heritage sites. The third, risk preparedness. The fourth, management of cultural landscapes. The fifth, management of historic centers. And the sixth, management of natural heritage. I've been fortunate enough to attend a training of the module number 1 and 5 in May of 2011 in Curacao. It's 1 and 5 again dealt with application for World Heritage Convention. Basically, the training of that module gives you the whole thing about the convention, what it's about, looking into the operational guidelines, what is required in terms of the dossier, preparing your document, Module 5 dealt with the management of historic centers. And these modules are up for grabs in a sense. I think Barbados did have one of the modules presented. I can't remember which one, a couple of years ago. If the college is interested, the college could opt to offer a course, one of these modules, and present it. There are opportunities for this to happen. The Department of Culture is embarking, and it's one of our responsibilities as part of the plan to form national or heritage committees, world heritage committees. Each state party is responsible for establishing these committees. And we are in the process of getting the formation of a World Heritage Committee, which will have its terms of reference. We will decide the makeup of the committee, which will be experts from the various related fields here in the territory. And of course, this will have to go through the ministry and the minister to take forward to cabinet, so that we can get the work of UNESCO going through this committee. So we hope to have that committee established this year, if at all possible. We have assisted with some archaeological digs in the past. Again, during my time as education officer responsible for culture, I've met Dr. Peter Jewett from the United Kingdom. He used to bring a number of students, of his archaeological students, study students to the BVI, and they would do digs. I remember him bringing students, and they had done quite some digs down at Belmont Estate, and they had also done a dig out there at the entrance of the college. I said the U.S. as well, because we had a team from the U.S. I can't recall the information at the moment, but we had a team as well coming from one of the universities from the U.S. And what we used to do basically is that we would facilitate their visit by helping them with the customs and immigration clearance and with Public Works Department helping them to excavate the site so that they can go in and do the actual digging to clear the site for them. So we kind of facilitated these things for these students and professors. And recently we had established a relationship with Dr. John Chenoweth. He had approached the department for assistance, and he is also from the U.S., and he was actually a doctoral student, and he was researching the Letsum site on Little Jocelyn Dyke. So again, we helped to facilitate his visit, and he too had brought students to the to help him. He came first by himself, and then the following year, he came with his students, where they did some digging at the Letsum site on Little Joss Van Dyke, and we again facilitated him with customs and immigration. Well, we couldn't take public works over there, but we assisted him with the boat to get over to Little Joss Van Dyke. And he gave us a report. We have a report from May to June of his work of 2009. I think we have two reports of his visits at the department. So if anyone is interested in seeing these reports, you may contact us, and we'll willingly allow you to see them. Why I place HLSCC on there? Because I've arranged, because he's bringing students and our limitations, I kind of agreed with Dr. Angel Smith that, you know, he will continue his works through the college. It would be an opportunity for the students in the Virgin Islands Studies program to connect with Dr. Chinowitz's students, and so the relationship that he could have with them better than us at the department. So we haven't given up on it. We haven't really thrown him over to the college, but we will assist in any way. But I thought it best that, you know, they'll have a better relationship from student to student exchange, and getting some of our students involved with the digs that he will be conducting in the future, because he has expressed an interest in continuing to do the research in the Virgin Islands. So that's what we have done in terms of the archaeological digs. And that's just some of the ideas, some of the initiatives that we have taken at the Department of Culture. Now, moving on to the Museums Association of the Caribbean, just to give you an idea of what it's all about. The Museums Association of the Caribbean, affectionately known as MAC, was established in 1987 to allow museums and related organizations and societies in the Caribbean to share experiences and skills. The MAC objectives were born out of the importance of museums as centers of conservation and preservation of natural and cultural patrimony and of our common heritage, as well as the vital role which museums play in the conservation, education systems, scientific research, and tourism of Caribbean states. The mission of MAC, getting lost in my papers here, to create a visible and accessible museum network for Caribbean museums and museum professionals to share knowledge and expertise. The vision is MAC will be a viable, visible regional organization that enables meaningful collaborations among Caribbean museums through its web presence, educational programs, annual conferences, and more. The objectives are there: to develop a common policy to the role of museums and duties of curatorial staff, with common practices on exhibitions, conservation, preservation, legislation and regulations for the protection of national patrimony, to act as an advisory board to government and public and private institutions on matters pertaining to museum development, to identify technical and financial resources at national, regional, and international levels, and to share information on needs and sources for assistance. And the list goes on: to serve as a forum for exchange of information and ideas, to develop links with international and other regional and national museum-related organizations and agencies, and to strengthen museums so that they may foster and promote an awareness, appreciation, and understanding of our heritage through education and related programs. The ongoing activities of MAC: we have an annual conference and general meeting every year, and these are switched around from member state to member state. Last year, the meeting was held in St. Lucia. This year, it's going to be in the Turks and Caicos Islands. There's a Museum Professional Exchange Program. It's open to all students in training. As a matter of fact, we have two students that have expressed interest in this exchange, one from Germany and one from Puerto Rico. So at the moment, the subcommittee that's responsible for placing the students at this, during this professional exchange, are working on getting the students at their request to have an exchange at a museum somewhere within the MAC network. Their lectures, their seminars, their workshops, and fundraising activities. I mentioned the museum's professional exchange program. It's an opportunity for students. These two students are actually, one is a grad, it's still in graduate school, one has just completed their graduate studies in the field, and they have actually requested the opportunity to have an exchange at a museum within the region. And ironically, both of them agreed to fund their own transportation to the venue of the museum, wherever it is in the region, and we're working feverishly to get them placed. The annual general conference will be held in the Cayman Islands. Did I say Turks and Caicos? I said Turks and Caicos. It's actually in the Cayman Islands from October 9th to the 11th. There's currently a call for papers. The theme for this year's conference is The Essential Museum, Redefining the Role of the Cultural and Heritage Sector for the 21st Century Audiences. So the call for papers have been put out on our website, and also on the different, and we have a newsletter, an e-newsletter that comes out, so the call for paper and all the details has been placed on those two media areas. We're looking at how can museums define and demonstrate our public value in the modern age? How can our institutions play integral roles in civic engagement, education, research, stewardship, and social change? How are our audiences and who are our audiences and what are their needs? Who are we not yet serving and how can we better connect? How can the digital realm help grow audiences and open up access for hard-to-reach communities? So that's the focus of the theme this year in the Cayman Islands. And persons are invited to submit papers for presentation to explore the questions, creating conservations, and we're inviting, in this particular sub-theme, we're inviting audience participation in the development of exhibitions, collections, development, and programming. And the other sub-theme is the changing environment, which is focusing on adapting our physical spaces for an increasingly digital society. And the final sub-theme is collaborations, partnerships, and mergers. And this is focusing on growing audiences through non-traditional partners. So the deadline for submission is June 15th, and your abstracts, you can submit for your, the deadline for your abstracts is June 15th, a maximum of 300 words. And again, you can visit the website and you can get more details on www.caribbeanmuseums.com. And we do have a website, yes. So if you find more information about that, you'll find information, details about the abstract, what it should include, etc. This is the executive of the MAC, the Museum Association of the Caribbean, and Dr. Shireen James Williams from Jamaica, West Indies. She is the president, vice president, yours truly, our secretary, Sheila Aris van der Mule de Burk. She would upset with me, I mispronounce her name, from the Netherlands, and the treasurer, Lloyd Jean-Pierre from St. Lucia. How do we connect? We connect via Skype. We have our monthly meetings via Skype. We have regular meetings, the executive meets a Skype as well. We communicate a lot through email. Actually, I was nominated to be on the executive or a board member in 2014 when I attended the annual general meeting in Jamaica. So I've been on the board, but recently selected as the vice president of the executive team. All right, so that's it for the the presentation about MAC, but also to say that the BVI has been very, very active in this organization. We have actually hosted a general meeting and conference in 2003. Because we see the significance of being a part, we're actually members of the association. We pay our dues. To become a member, you're welcome to as well. You can do a membership drive. Just simply visit the website and there's an application. Students are encouraged. Your interest being in the field, your interest encouraged to be a member of the museum of this organization, because we are having a member. We are continuously advocating for membership. So I will wrap up basically by talking a bit about the way forward and how we see things at the Department of Culture. Dr. Catherine mentioned the works of previous efforts. There's so many reports on historical sites. You name it, it's been done. Works, I've been told that, you know, efforts to get on the World Heritage List is way before me. Like I said, they had mentioned about the copper mine being considered, the baths being considered, the Kingstown Church being considered. So we just recognize the work of, and I'm suggesting that or proposing that we sort of do a review, and we go onto the shelves and go into the cupboards and we on the bookshelves and cupboards and just simply pull out these reports. We will be amazed of the work that has been done in this particular area. The compilation of the list, I was given a list just yesterday of 484 sites that somebody had compiled. I think there's a thick document as well of all these historical sites here in the Virgin Islands. So the work is vast. So if we can just take a moment, not just a moment, it wouldn't take a moment, but to find all of these things that have been done so we can move forward. Instead of reinventing the wheel, let's review what has been done. And yes, we recognize the importance of the preservation of the sites. Without them, our history is lost. I think, you know, when you talk to some people, they're kind of cynical. Those ruins, they have nothing there. You know, it's just a waste of time, or they're already dilapidated. What can you do to restore these sites? But I think we need to educate. We need to communicate. We need to educate the populace about the importance of these sites. Of course, we have a limited resources, finances, our technical people. It's growing, I must say, in terms of the experts in the field. It's growing here in the Virgin Islands. But our resources are limited, so I am proposing that we pool our resources. We come together and decide how we're going to move forward, because we're kind of duplicating efforts in a sense. We're kind of fragmented here in the Virgin Islands. I'm doing something, the Department of Culture is doing this, college is doing that, somebody else is doing this, but we're going in different directions in some cases. And in other cases, we're going in the same direction, but we're not crossing paths or something like that. We don't know what each other is doing in some instances. So with the limited resources that we have, I'm proposing that if we pool our resources, it will be more beneficial for the territory. Collaboration is key. And one of the things that we are proposing to do is to have a focal point or conference with government agencies, and at the moment it will be just be government agencies that has anything to do with culture, not just necessarily focusing on historical sites, but all the government agencies that has a mandate to do something about culture. We're going to bring us all together and we're going to present ourselves and give an idea of what activities we are doing so that we can see how we can best work together, how we can pool our resources. And we hope as well to have this done this year by bringing all these government agencies. Because funds are very low. And expertise, if we can all just, you know, come together, it will be a benefit. And I'm proposing that through the World Heritage Committee, the committee that hopefully will be formed this year, and it will include a number of you out there in the audience, because it will be very wide. We will have to include persons from our sister islands as well to serve on this committee, related organizations to serve on this committee, and the NGOs as well to serve on this committee. So if we can use the World Heritage Committee as a focal point for the preservation of our historical sites, because as I said, UNESCO has a vast amount of information that we can use that we don't necessarily have to reinvent the wheel when it comes to the preservation of our historical sites. And of course, we need to come up with a plan. We need to come up with a strategic plan as to how we're going to move forward, how we're going to deal with this. Are we going to do this first? Are we going to set up a five-year plan, a five-year strategic plan that we're going to do it in phases? Are we going to, whatever the decision is, but recognizing the work that has been done before, we can pull it out. The Department of Culture is committed. We are always willing to assist. We're always, with our limitations, we are still willing to assist in whatever we can do, whatever our capabilities would allow us. We are committed to the cause. We have been doing it for quite some time, and I think we are making headway. The fact that we are now connected to the UK, although it's a tedious process when it comes to UNESCO, we are still hopeful that we will be able to one day get on the World Heritage List. I think that's my presentation. Any questions? Yes. Well, yes. It's the Department of Culture right now is putting it together. We are going to be drafting the terms of reference. I've collected quite a bit of terms of reference from my colleagues in the region so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel. And the idea is to put forward the list of related experts, again, the NGOs and others, government agencies, various government agencies, Tourist Board, UNESCO, the college, etc., yourselves, the Joss Van Dyke Preservation Society, and others, of course. We put forward the names to the minister for consideration and prepare a cabinet paper, go to cabinet, and hopefully cabinet will approve it. So that's the process. So we're in the process of preparing the paper to go to the minister for forward submission to cabinet for approval. We can possibly, the persons that will be recommended, we'd have to make the recommendations, of course, to the minister, and hopefully he will approve, and then we can have a meeting with those persons. What I've been doing on the side, though, is contacting the individuals that we're considering to ask if they will be interested in serving on this committee before we can send them forward to the minister. And so we will be contacting you very soon.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Luce.
You're welcome.
Wonderful, thank you.
Another? Yes. Yes.
Thank you. So far, we had not been working with the Department of Culture. Mm-hmm. But we did get some help from government, but it's all dried up. And it's difficult to persuade, various branches of government to assist, to also complete it. It's gone a long way towards completion. And the small amount that we have to, we need to complete that, it is not much compared to what we spent already. So we have never tried the Department of Culture. We have an involved department. Do you think at this point we could involve the Department of Culture?
Well, I wouldn't say no, Mr. Vanterpool, but basically I would say that one of the priority areas for the Minister, Honorable Walren, this year for the department is to look into the formation of a cultural foundation. Yes. And of course, again, we talked about our limitations, and finances is one of those limitations. Yes. So with the formation of the cultural foundation, we hope that we can raise funds for these things.
Okay.
Because what had happened in terms of your approaching now, we've already been through the budget process. So, but I wouldn't say that we can't assist.
Okay.
But it means that we'll have to readjust ourselves. So you can submit something in writing for consideration.
Of course I will.
Because I don't think the cultural foundation will be established right away. So it's just something that was given to us to as part of his priority areas for culture this year.
Right.
And I'm sure most of you in here would agree that a cultural foundation is something that we can strive to achieve, because there's so many projects. The St. Philip's right now need a bunch of money to get completed. You're going to finish your mill. So, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.